From now on, I will speak in English. I hope you can understand me easily, and we will enjoy the lesson. Now, for today's course, we will focus on what is academic writing, because we are focusing on the basics of academic English. And academic English is based on writing and speaking, and it is oral presentation, and also because we are, well, most of us are Turkish citizens, we have to get acquainted with the global literature. So in this context, it would be beneficial for us to find out the translation strategies in translating the academic text from to Turkish to English or from English to Turkish. My outline is like this, and for today's course, we will focus on what is academic writing and structure of academic writing. So what is academic writing? What could you say? We will rather ask them. So academic writing is not a product of the writer's imagination, nor a means for a writer to express his or her personal approach to daily issues, up-to-date problems, or abstract topics. Academic writing, so what is it? If it is not a product of the writer's imagination, or if it is not a means for a writer to express his or her personal ideas, so what is it? Academic writing is the result of a research carried out in relation to an argument or hypothesis claimed by its writers. And academic papers all have an argument. This is important. All academic papers have an argument, and this argument represents the result found out as a result of the findings in the research performed. And like different sorts of writing, academic writing has its peculiar structure. So what does an academic paper have? Abstract, introduction, body, and conclusion paragraph. But I will not first tell abstract, but rather I will tell this in the end. I will rather focus on now the introduction part. So what is the introduction part? Well, introduction part sets out to describe the purpose and the main argument of academic papers. Specifically, the purpose of introduction is to give readers a rough idea about the content and the main idea of the paper. In introducing the problematized issue in the paper to the readers, the writer follows a systematic approach in the introduction part. So so the methods of reasoning can be considered as the embodiment of systematic approach in introduction part. So what are these methods of reasoning? Deduction and induction. Maybe most of you have heard about this, right? Yeah, so what is deduction? Known as top-down logic, deduction signifies reaching a conclusion reductively by applying general rules which hold over the entirety of the closed domain of discourse, narrowing the range under consideration until the conclusion or conclusions remains. So, just an example, all men are equal, all men are mortal. This is a general statement, right? And Shakespeare is a man. This is more specific, right? So from general to specific. So based on these two arguments, what sort of argument can we make? Shakespeare is a mortal. So so we may reach some generalizations, or we may make some arguments by following a general to specific approach in deduction part. And in the introduction part of the academic papers, we follow the deduction technique as the major method of reasoning. And another part, induction, known as bottom-up logic, induction stands for reaching conclusion by generalization or extrapolation from specific cases to general rules. This is important. Look, in deduction, we said from general to specific. And in induction part, from specific cases to general rules. And a well-known technique in literature using inductive reasoning is Socratic dialogue, in which an intellectual asks a character in need of knowledge specific questions to help him or her to draw a logical conclusion and hence get enlightened about moral issues. In literature, for example, you know Plato and his work, The Republic. In the Republic epitomizes Socratic dialogue technique, and as a basic characteristic of Socratic dialogue in the work, the narrator gets enlightened about the characteristics of an ideal state or government based on the specific questions asked by the intellectual. This is important. So in the interaction part, we don't follow the specific to general rules. What do? We focus on deduction from general ideas to specific issues. So considering all these methods of reasoning, what is literature review? Literature review, you may say, literature review may be about literature, or rather fiction, theater, novel. Is this right? No. Literature review is not related to the works of literature, such as novel, poetry, or drama. So what is it? With literature review, the writer presents to readers what has been written so far about the subject matter of his or her academic papers. To do this, the writer provides a background information as the basis of the paper. So how can a writer provide a background information about the basic argument of the paper? Well, in fact, the background information provided in the paper can show changes according to the scientific discipline to which the research paper is related. For example, an academic paper, you are writing a paper on colonial or postcolonial literature, right? So in this context, the writer presenting a paper or producing a paper on colonial and postcolonial studies provides a theoretical background information with reference to works by such theorists as Edward Said, Franz Fanon, Ngugi Wa Thiong'o, etc. And if you are writing a paper, for example, on history or a specific period of time in history, the writer provides a background information about the social, political, and economic circumstances of the timeline concerned. At this point, the writer may benefit from either the original sources written in that period of time in history, such as chronicles, journals, and manuscripts, or the works by theorists concerning the scientific discipline of the papers. So what we do in literature review is to provide general information, because when you write something over on a theory, this is general. And deductive reasoning is employed in the interaction part. So while literature review provides a general overview of the subject matter, the writer presents his or her approach to the topic of the paper with the statement of main argument. The main idea can, of course, be expressed in one sentence or a couple of sentences in more details in line with this general to specific method. Look, this is very important. In the introduction part, your method of reasoning or your method of logic should be from general to specific. And in line with this approach, the writer also explains the outline of the methods to be employed in this study, the case studies to be conducted, as well as the arguments in line with the main argument of the paper. The expression of the main argument, case studies to be employed, and the statement of ideas in line with the main argument not only makes an effective introduction, but also helps readers to get prepared for further details of the paper, findings, citations by the primary or secondary sources in the body parts of the research paper. So this is the introduction part. So as you see, as we understand from its name, introduction part helps readers to get acquainted, get familiarized with the main topic or the main argument of the paper. The writer first puts or provides and presents a general background information or theoretical background information about the main topic, and then he specifically focuses on the main argument and what he will do, the methods to be used, etc. But what about the body part? What will we do? So what is this, the function of the body part in academic writing? The writer develops the main argument of the paper in body part. The writer presents the proofs to render the argument valid in a scientific sense. For example, some methods to validate the main claim of an academic paper are interviews, questionnaires, experiments, qualitative and quantitative research practices, or citations from primary or secondary sources. So the writer presents the research with all its details: the technique employed, the duration of the research, the circumstances under which the research was employed, and of course, in the introduction part, the writer introduces the main topic, but in the body part, the author presents proofs or documents or findings to reinforce or to render his argument stronger or believable in the reader's eyes. And so the writer, to reinforce his or her ideas credible, the writer presents the research with all its details, and the content of the body part shows changes according to the scientific discipline with which the subject matter of the paper is concerned. And of course, similar to the introduction part, in writing the body part of the academic writer, the academic paper, the writer follows a systematic approach to develop the main argument of the paper. So how or what sort of systematic approach does the writer use in the body part? So let's see it. TEEL, this is our keyword. And so the first T is the topic sentence. In each paragraph you write in the body part, you have to follow this structure: topic sentence, explanation, evidence, and link. So what is the topic sentence? Topic sentence, it is the first sentence that describes the claim or argument of the body paragraph. And the argument of body paragraph is always related to the main idea of an academic paper. So in each paragraph, when you write the first sentence, first you help the readers to get familiarized with the argument of that paragraph. And then, explanation part, the writer elaborates on the argument of the body paragraph and puts explanatory details to make the claim clear to understand for the readers. The argument is explained in a more detailed and comprehensive manner. Yes, first the author has described the argument, and then he has put explanatory statements. But is there any proof? Yes, evidence. So, following the explanation of the argument in body paragraph, the writer presents the evidence that supports the argument. So, how can the author, or what sorts of evidence should the author use? The evidence can include case studies, experiments, statistics, qualitative or quantitative research practices, citations from chronicles, diaries, essays, journal articles, books, or book chapters. And the evidence benefited to support the argument in body paragraph changes according to the scientific discipline to which the paper is related. For example, if you are writing a paper on the science of statistics or statistics, yes, you have to use statistics or cognitive or quantitative research practices. So if you are writing a paper on for example, biology, in this case, you have to use experiments or qualitative or quantitative research practices. Or if you are writing a paper on human sciences, so in this case, you have to use, you benefit from the chronicles, diaries, essays, articles, books, or book chapters. So in this context, what we say is the evidence benefited to support the argument in body paragraph changes according to the scientific discipline to which the paper is related. However, it is important that all the evidence benefited in the paper will require appropriate citation to reinforce the argument in body paragraph that is closely linked to the main argument of the academic paper. And comment. Comment may look like a subjective remark, but in using comments here in the academic papers, the writer does not express a personal opinion. So what does he say? The writer discusses the strength and limitations of the evidence presented in the paragraph, as well as the extent to which the evidence supports the claim in the paragraph. Hence, the writer makes a critical analysis of the evidence to maintain the scientific validity of the claim in the body paragraph, in addition to the main argument of the paper. And when making a critical analysis of the evidence, or when the writer makes a comment on the evidence provided, the writer either supports or refutes it based on the scientific justification or the findings in the paper. So when a writer supports an evidence, he or she uses some words. What are these words? And similarly, likewise, in line with, moreover, furthermore. But when a writer aims to refute or oppose the idea expressed in the evidence, he uses the conjunction but, however, nevertheless, on the contrary, contrary to, conversely, as opposed to. Right? So, and the link. Yes, the writer has described the argument, he has explained it, and then put some evidences and made a critical analysis or evaluation of the evidence. So, what is the link? Following the presentation and critical discussion of the evidence in the body paragraph, the writer summarizes the main idea of the paragraph and clarifies how the claim in the body paragraph contributes to the main argument of the paper. At some point, the writer may end the paragraph with a transition sentence which helps the readers to get prepared for the main idea of the next body paragraph. This is important. And so in the body paragraph, so what we say is in the introduction in the introduction part, the writer has introduced the subject matter. In the body paragraph, he has put some details or findings, experiments, the findings of a research, etc. But and he has discussed about the different ideas in the paper. And what about the conclusion part? Most of us can think conclusion. Yes, in writing a conclusion paragraph, we make a summary of the paper. Is this really so? No. Well, so what is the function of conclusion part in academic writing? This is important. Well, conclusion part is significant for making concluding remarks and covering the subject matter of the paper. Presentation of the results related to the research discussed in the paper and the statements of the general ideas that support the main argument of the paper establish the basis of conclusion part in academic papers. And there are, of course, some phrases that the authors use in conclusion part. What are they? In conclusion, to conclude, to sum up, all in all, the writers use each one of these words to start the conclusion paragraph in academic papers. And there are, of course, systematic approach in conclusion part, deduction and induction. So in the introduction part, we said deduction is used from general to specific. So what about the conclusion part? In conclusion part, induction is used. Why? Because in the induction part, you make a specific statement, and then based on these specific statements, you reach a general conclusion. So how can we write a conclusion in this sense? Well, the authors begin conclusion by restating or re-emphasizing their approach to the main topic of the paper, and so put emphasis on their main argument in the conclusion part. Based on the statement of the main argument and the outlook on the subject matter of the paper, the author summarizes the key points and the arguments that support the main argument of the paper. Yes, of course, in the conclusion part, you make a summary of all the issues discussed in the paper, but conclusion does a lot more than summarizing the ideas or arguments. So what is the function of conclusion? Well, the conclusion part leads readers to consider about the broader significance of the subject matter of the academic papers. The conclusion part discusses why it is difficult to arrive at a definitive answer or absolute answer to the question posed in the paper. And the conclusion part raises questions that could be considered as the possible subject matters of the future papers. The conclusion part presents the author's predictions about the probabilities concerning the subject matter problematized in the paper. And the conclusion part also offers some suggestions for the resolution of the issues problematized in the paper. And so, as you see, in writing the conclusion part, the writer, yes, summarized the major topic, but but the authors also provide some solutions, alternatives for the problems in the papers, and they may offer or they may make some predictions about the features of the subject matter, or they may also offer you some sources for reading for future research, right? But so we have talked about the introduction part, body part, and the conclusion part. So the writing has finished. Is that right? No. So there is one part, abstract. Most of us see, so what is an abstract? Because most of us have some difficulty in writing abstract, or sometimes we may overlook, oh, abstract, this, oh, abstract part is really not so important. No, abstract, yes, it may look a very brief part of the paper, but abstract is the backbone or the or is very wide, is a very crucial part of the academic paper. So what is the abstract? An abstract is a short summary of a published or unpublished research paper, usually about a paragraph, circa 6 or 7 sentences, 150 or to 200 words. But this word limit changes from journals to journal to journal, or from one conference organizer to another conference organizer. Because I have experienced some abstract word limits that extend to 300 words or 250 words, right? And so, although the abstract looks a very short part of the academic papers, they have of this also has some functions. So what are these functions? Well, an abstract enables readers to get the gist or essence of your paper or article quickly in order to decide whether to read the paper or not. For example, I am searching for some sources on global warming or climate change. I have started, for example, some sort of research on Google or some databases like EBSCOhost, JCTOR, etc. And then what do I have to read first? The abstract. And then I read the abstract. This article sounds interesting to me, so I have to read it. Or I say, I read the abstract and say, no, this is not relevant to my subject. So when we read the abstracts, we can understand whether the article is helpful for our research or not. Based on this, we can understand this. And for example, we have decided that the abstract is, or the article is helpful for our research, and we have started reading the abstract. An abstract, in this case, prepares the readers to follow a detailed information, analysis, and arguments in the full paper. An abstract helps readers to remember key points from the paper. Search engines, for example, EBSCOhost, ProQuest, JCTOR, and bibliographic databases use abstracts as well as the titles of the papers to identify key terms for indexing the published papers. Content of the abstract. Well, abstracts present the major arguments in relation to the main idea of the paper concisely. The proportion of the abstract the author devotes to each argument and information varies depending upon the nature and genre of the paper summarized in the abstract. In some cases, some of the information provided in the abstract may be implied instead of exist statement to arouse some sort of curiosity in the reader's minds. So what sort of, yes, the author writes the abstract, but what sorts of information does the author put in the abstract? Well, the context or background information concerning the research topic of the paper, the general subject matter, and the specific topic of the research discussed in the paper, the central questions or statement of the problem, what is already known about the problematized issue in the paper, what previous researchers have shown or found out, the reasons, the rationale, and goals for the research. For example, why it is important to address the questions in the paper, why that topic is worth examining or discussing, and hence the extent of originality in the paper and the innovation it supposedly brings to the scientific arena. So when you write an abstract is very important because it shows the level of originality of your paper, and then the findings, research methods, the significance of the findings in the research. So presenting all this information, an abstract needs to be intelligible without further need to read the full paper to make the misunderstood points clear. In the abstract, the writer does not cite references about the findings, arguments, and the ideas. The specific literature is cited in the body part of the academic paper, not in the abstract. Yes, this is important because citation is not provided in the abstract. This is a very important aspect. And so when to write an abstract? When do you write an abstract, for example? When you start writing a paper or in the end? Yes, although it's a popular tendency to write the abstract before the full paper, as it will appear as the very first part of the paper, it's a good idea to write the abstract when the draft of the full paper is completed, because this helps the author to know in advance what is summarized in the abstract part. Thank you for listening.
Evet hocam, ağzınıza sağlık.
Teşekkür ederim. Umarım sıkıcı olmamıştır. İngilizcem biraz yüksek gelmişse eğer diye düşünüyorum. Şimdi isteyenlere Türkçe bir özet geçelim.
Aynen.
Şimdi akademik yazma dediğimiz iş mesela şimdi nedir? İki çeşit yazı türü var değil mi? Kurgusal ve kurgusal olmayan. Kurgusal olan yazılarda mesela romandır, şiirdir, tiyatrodur değil mi? Burada hepsinde yazarın bir kurgusu var. Bir hayal gücüne faydalanıyorsunuz değil mi? Veya kurgusal olmayan mesela denemeler var. Gazete yazıları var. Orada yazar gel ne yapıyor? Kendi şahsi görüşünü söylüyor. Bence böyle yapılmalıdır, şu olmalıdır, bu olmalıdır. İşte ülkedeki ekonomik durum şu olmalı, politik karışıklıklar şöyle çözülmeli falan dış beşmekendir. Ama akademik yazma böyle değil. Akademik yazmanın kendine has bir yapısı var. Yani akademik yazma ne kişisel görüş odaklıdır, ne de yazarın kurgusuna veya hayal gücüne dayalıdır. O zaman akademik yazma dediğimiz şey nedir? Akademik yazma, belirli bir araştırmada elde edilen bulguların sistematik bir şekilde araştırmacılara veya okurlara sunulduğu bir yazı türüdür. O zaman, peki tabii her yazma gibi bunların da kendilerine özgü bir sistematik bir parçası var. Nedir? Abstract dedik değil mi? Özet, introduction, giriş, body gelişme, conclusion, sonuç paragrafı. Ve giriş bölümünde de ne dedik? Yazar hani konuyu tanımlar. Hani makaledeki ana fikri nedir? Onu bir açıklar. Ama onu açıklarken ne dedik işte? Bir mantık yürütme şekilleri var dedik değil mi? O mantık yürütme şekillerini kastettiğimiz neydi? Deduction, induction. Deduction, induction. Yani tümden gelin tüme varım değil mi? Tümden gelinden de ne yapıyoruz? Genelden özele doğru gidiyoruz. Peki bu genelden özele doğru gidişi yazar girişte ne yapıyor? Önce hani konuyu tanıtıyor. Hani bir teorik, bir hani kuramsal bilgi verebilir. Veya bu kuramsal bilgi tabii bilim dalına göre değişiklik de gösterebilir. Mesela nedir? Hani eğer siz bir sömürgecilik üzerine, emperyalizm hakkında araştırma yapıyorsanız, bu alandaki kuramcılar kimdir? Edward Said, Frantz Fanon gibi kuramcılara faydalanırsınız. Veya bir tarihsel bir dönem inceliyorsunuz. O zaman o dönemdeki hani o galgacı anlatan bir tarihsel bir background bilgi verirsiniz. O zamanki işte günlükler, yazmalar, işte yazılar, dergi yazılarından faydalanırsınız değil mi? Yani bu şekilde bunlar yapılıyor. Şimdi bu genel girişten sonra bu genel bir teorik sunum dediğimizde literature review diyoruz buna. Literature review dediğimizde aslında literatür incelemesi. Şimdi bazı kişiler hani diyebilir. Literatür incelemesi dediğimizde nedir işte? Bilgin edebiyat. Hayır. Literature review dediğimizde daha önce o bilimlerinde, o konuda neler yapılmış, neler yapılmamış. Ne yapıldı? Onları yazmanız gerekiyor ki onun üzerine sen farklı ne söyleyeceksin? Onu getireceksin. Kullanılan yöntemler nelerdir? Onları anlatacaksın. Bu şekilde gidecek. Gelişme bölümüne geldiğimizde şimdi giriş bölümünde hani konuyu tanıttın. Peki gelişme bölümünde konuyu biraz daha artık detaylı sunman lazım. Değil mi? Nasıl yapacaksınız onu? Onun işte nedir işte? Alıntılar, işte mülakatlar, nitel ve nicel gözlemler, ondan sonra deneyler. Ama tabii bakın giriş bölümünde yazdığı, kullandığınız bu yöntemler bilim dalından bilim dalına farklılık gösterir. Şimdi mesela bir biyoloji veya fizik alanında bir şey yazacaksanız, deney yaparsanız, değil mi? Gözlem yaparsanız, onun sonuçlarını yazarsınız. İstatistik bilimindeyseniz, işte istatistikleri hazırlarsınız, raporlar hazırlarsınız, onun sonuçlarını koyarsınız. Yani benim gibi İngiliz edebiyatındaysanız, o zaman hani işte günlükler, günceler, anılar, memoir dediğimiz türlerden faydalanıp bir sonuca varırsınız gibi gibi. Tabii bunu yaparken de bir şekilde de bir sistematik bir gidişi var. Nedir işte? Her bir paragrafta mesela bir ana düşünce, yani şimdi her bir paragrafın kendi düşüncesi var. Ve o düşünceyi anlatırken önce düşünceni hani yazıyorsunuz, onu detaylandırıyorsunuz, ayrıntılandırıyorsunuz ama o düşüncenizin okurun gözünde inandırıcı olması için bir takım kanıtlar sunmanız lazım. Nedir işte onlar? Hani interview, mülakatlar olur, görüşmeler olur, işte experiment, deneylerin sonuçları olur gibi şey yapıyorsunuz. Ve onun üzerine işte hani eğer o belirten görüşe, o anlatı yaptığınız görüşe katılıyorsanız, şu ifadeleri kullanıyorsanız, reddediyorsanız bunları kullanıyorsunuz. Ve sonuç ve daha sonra makalenin sonuç bölümüne geldiğinizde ise hani sonuç kısmı dediğimizde hani çoğu kişinin aklına gelen nedir? Ya işte makalenin özetini yazarım, işi bitiririm. Yani tabii yani sonuç bölümünde tabii özet verilir. Ama sonuç bölümü hani İngilizce anlattığımda da söylediğim üzere sonuç bölümü özetlemeden çok daha fazlasını yapar. Çünkü o anlatılan hani problem neyse işte o problemin gelecekte alabileceği yönde getireceği değişime dair tahminlerde bulunabilir. Ya da o konu hakkında yazar bir takım çözümler sunabilir. Veya ileride bu konuda araştırma yapmak isteyen kişiler var ise eğer o araştırmalar hakkında mesela okuma malzemesi veya kaynağı önerebilir. Bu şekilde bir akademik şekilde makale yazılabilir. Şimdi ben bu hafta size bu anlattıklarım nedir? Akademik bir yazının parçaları, unsurları, yapısı nedir diye anlattım. Umarım faydalı olmuştur. İşte Türkçe öğretimimiz de bu şekilde.